And welcome to our lecture this evening on the month of Kislev. You have the handouts in which we have many of the different elements and many of the different ideas of the power and the energy of the month of Kislev. And what we're going to try to do tonight is speak about many of the different elements that become strong and become relevant and become that are celebrated in the month of Kislev. I will try to speak about the energy of the month and thereby being able to tie everything together. There are two different ways that you could approach something. You could either look at the details and try to figure out the core of it, or you can go to the core and then focus on the details. See, the problem with focusing on the core is sometimes when you focus on the core too much, you don't get to the details. And the details are usually where the exciting, where their excitement is. On the other hand, if you focus on the details, you don't get to the core. Excuse me, you can overlook and you could miss the fundamentals of what something is. When we speak of a person is made up of many different details or different elements in our character, in our personality, in our behavior. And when we look at a person, or when we speak of a person, we could speak about this element in the person's behavior, or that element in the person's behavior. But if we don't get to the core of the person, we never really get it. We have many, many different details, but there's something fundamental that we're lacking in the knowledge of that person. As opposed to if we focus on the core, on the essence of the person, you really get to know the person. But practically speaking, how does it play itself out? We don't really know. What we're going to try to do tonight is focus on the details of the month of Kislev. So we're going to focus on the holidays. We're going to focus on the different energy. We're going to focus on the zodiac sign. But not just focusing on these different details. We'll also try to speak of the energy of Kislev as a whole, which in turn will enable us to understand and enable us to come to bring all the information together and to have a solid understanding of what this month is all about, to enable us to tap into this month, to enable us to experience this month the way we could and the way we should, that when we see something, when we go through something during this month, that we understand what we're talking about. You won't mind me making some notes while I'm talking, or I'll pause for a moment. So through taking the approach of the details and then pointing out how all this comes together, because it is an extension, it is an offshoot of the core essence of Kislev, we'll be able to get an appreciation of both the details as well as the energy of the month. So the month of Kislev, let's just take a step back for a moment. The month of Kislev is the third month, on the Hebrew calendar. On the normal Hebrew calendar. When I say the normal Hebrew calendar, I'm referring to because usually we refer to the year beginning on Rosh Hashanah, the first month being Tishrei, the second month being Cheshvan, which finished on Shabbos, on this past Shabbos, and the third month being Kislev, and so on and so forth. There's also another way of counting the months, starting the month of Nisan being first, Iyar being second, and so on. And if we count in that direction, the month of Kislev is the ninth month of the year. So number one, I'm going to go through according to the order that we have it on the handouts that I've distributed. I'm going to point out some of the different details and then try to bring everything together, explain what we're talking about, and try to bring it all together. In Tanakh, the month of Kislev is not mentioned, to the best of my knowledge. It's referred to in the Torah in a number of places, usually referred to as the third month, when it is referred. So we're talking about the third month. Not always is the third month referring to Kislev. Many times when the Torah tells us the third month, it's referring to the month of Sivan. We won't get into that right now. According to Kabbalah, there are correlations between the month of Kislev and the month of Sivan. I said earlier, there are two ways that we start counting the month, to counting the year, either from Tishrei or from Nisan. So Tishrei is one and Nisan is one. Cheshvan is two, Iyar is two, Kislev is three, Sivan is three. These are two different ways of counting the year. This is based on a discussion in the Talmud. I'm not going to get into all the details of this, but I'm just going to mention that there are two different ways of counting, and that's why you see the biblical name is the ninth month or the third month. But there is a correlation the Kabbalah teaches us between the third month of Sivan and the third month of Kislev, and perhaps we'll get to that a bit later. The major holiday of this month is Yom Tov that we all enjoy, we all celebrate, we all brings very fond memories of the Yom Tov of Hanukkah. When we get together with family and we light the menorah, we have the latkes, the ponchikes. Some people are smiling.
In anticipation.
In anticipation. Some people are laughing out loud in anticipation. No, but there's something very warm and gives a very warm feeling over Hanukkah, gathering with family, which is part of what Hanukkah is all about. In addition, on the Chabad calendar, and not just the Chabad calendar, but the Hasidic calendar, there's also another Yom Tov, Yutus Kislev, the 19th of Kislev, which is referred to no less as Rosh Hashanah for Hasidus. So these are two major events that we have in the month of Kislev. The major letter of the alphabet, of the primary letter of the alphabet of this month, is the letter Samach. The numerical value of Samach is 60. We'll get to that as well. Finally, the sign, the mazel of the month, is Mazel Keshes in Hebrew. Mazel Keshes, Sagittarius, Bo. What exactly this means, what is exactly the energy of this mazel, is yet to be described. The tribe, we know that there are 12 tribes, 12 Jewish tribes, representing the 12 children of Jacob. The tribe of the month is the tribe of Binyamin. The element of the month is fire. The sense, is referred to as chush, is sleep. The controller is the belly, keva, and the color is violet blue. There are many other elements and characteristics of this month that we will discuss as we move along. So we'll begin with the Yom Tov of Hanukkah. I want to discuss the holidays first. What is Hanukkah exactly? What do we celebrate on Hanukkah?
Light.
You're watching a little too much TV. But it's true. It's true that we celebrate light, but what does this mean? I'm going to point out, I'm not going to go through the entire story of Hanukkah. I'm assuming that many of you know it, and if you don't know it, you still have time to read up on it before Hanukkah comes up. But I want to speak of a few of the core points of what Hanukkah is all about. The Jewish people were living in Israel, and this goes back around 3,500 years. I'm sorry, 2,500 years to the times of this first Holy Temple. And the Greeks, Alexander the Great and so on, and took control of Eretz Yisrael. And at a later point, the different emperors, well, not the emperors, the different kings of the Greeks took control of Eretz Yisrael. And we know there was the Hellenization of Israel, of the Jewish people. And the Hellenists And the Greeks, when they conquered a land, they didn't just want to take control and collect taxes. They wanted to look after the well-being of the inhabitants of the land that they took over. And they did so, Hellenizing Israel. Many of the Jewish people became Hellenized. What does Hellenization mean? That they became more normal. That the Jewish people became more worldly. They didn't just communicate in Hebrew, they communicated in Greek as well. They learned, many of them learned math. Those that weren't proficient in math earlier, they started enjoying better roads. They started enjoying sporting events, competitions, and so on and so forth. Becoming Hellenized, becoming more worldly. Now, becoming worldly doesn't seem like a terrible thing, especially in our community. Being worldly is seen as a very positive thing. As many will tell me, you know what, it's okay, you don't want to keep Yiddishkeit, you can keep Yiddishkeit. But why does that have to be at the expense of dropping everything else, and so on? Dropping worldliness, be worldly as well as Jewish. And the truth of the matter is that this is a very old debate. At what point is your worldliness taking away from your Jewishness? And this took place at that time. The Greeks were the mighty nation at that time. When they came in with all their glory and their might and their seduction, many people went for it. You know, there's nothing wrong with it. I could still keep Shabbos and I could still keep whatever I want in Yiddishkeit and be more worldly. But after a while, it became very clear that, you know what, this is not helping Yiddishkeit. This is not helping the Jewish people become closer to Hashem and live the way Hashem wants them to live. But on the contrary, it's taking them away from living the way Hashem wants them to live. But how are you going to stop us? How are you going to stop Hellenization? How are you going to stop the Greeks from implementing the laws that they did in Israel? How are you going to stop this revolution from taking place? So there was a small family, an important family, but a family, no less, a small family. Matasyahu and his five children that gathered, and they started a revolt against the Greeks, the Greek Assyrians. And sure enough, after fighting for long enough, miraculously, they were victorious over the Greeks. What did they restore? What is the primary miracle of Hanukkah? That they were victorious over the Greeks, but not just the fact that they were victorious over a mighty nation. Imagine today a small tribe is to take on a mighty country. Doesn't make any sense that the small tribe should win. So the story of Hanukkah is not just the story of a victory of a small group of people over a mighty nation and a mighty army, but it's a victory of holiness over impurity. Something that is refined, something that is godly, a victory of godliness over worldliness. Godliness over Hellenization, purity, spirituality, holy spirituality over darkness. And therefore, as was said properly earlier, that it's a victory of lights, it's a miracle of lights, a holiday of lights. What kind of lights are we talking about? It's really a victory of spirituality. So this is, in two words, what Hanukkah is about. We celebrate it by lighting a candle, by lighting candles every night of Hanukkah, because Hanukkah, as we said, because candles are the most spiritual physical object that we have. We also commemorate the different miracle that happened in the temple, is that the priests were looking, when they came back into the temple, they wanted to rededicate the temple. They were looking for oil, not just regular oil that they used on a regular basis to light the menorah. They were looking for pure oil, for holy oil. And they could not find this purified oil, aside from one small jug, which should have lasted only for one night. Miraculously, it ended up lasting for 8 nights. This is not the end. So we have the miracle of the lights. we have the miracle of the victory, and more than anything else, we have the miracle of spirituality, of holiness, of purity over everything that stands against it, over everything that stands in its way. This is the story of Hanukkah. We celebrate it with our children. We celebrate it with our families. Because we want to bring this message of holiness and purity into our life. Obviously, we could spend much more time on Hanukkah, many, many hours on Hanukkah. It's a beautiful Yom Tov, and the messages are very profound and very deep. But we want to focus on the entire month of Kislev as a whole, not just on the different particular details. The second holiday, Yutus Kislev, the 19th of Kislev. What happened? There was a challenge placed on the teachings of Hasidus. What is Hasidus? In two words, it's the depth and the spirituality of Judaism. There are a lot of different elements in Yiddishkeit. A lot of different elements in the teachings of Yiddishkeit. There's Chumash, there's Gemara, there's Halacha. These are fundamentals of Yiddishkeit and the building blocks of what we are, of Jewish knowledge, of Jewish wisdom. There's another teaching that was introduced, another path and system in Jewish thinking, the teachings of Hasidus, which did not come to add anything in Yiddishkeit, God forbid, but on the contrary, to reveal, to explain to us the beauty of everything that we have, to point out the depth of the spiritual depth of what we have in Yiddishkeit, the spiritual depth and the brilliance of Chumash, the spiritual depth and brilliance of Talmud, of Halacha, and so on and so forth, of Kabbalah. So Hasidus has not come to teach anything new, but Hasidus came to show us, to deliver to us, that which we had already had, that which was already given to us. And like every major revelation in Jewish teachings, the teachings of Hasidus also came under major attack. Now, to point out how significant the teachings of Hasidus are, I hear this all the time of different people that were brought up in Yiddishkeit. They were brought up, so to speak, living a religious life. But after 10, 20, 50, 60, 30 years, they turn around and they say to themselves, you know what, this feels very empty. This feels insignificant. This doesn't talk to me. I'm just doing a bunch of rituals. I'm just doing a bunch of details. But I'm not experiencing anything. I feel like I'm missing something fundamental. We were talking earlier about sometimes when you have a bunch of details, but you don't have the core essence of something. There are people that feel that with regards to their Yiddishkeit. Yeah, I might put on tefillin. Yeah, I might keep kosher and I might keep shah. I might do a bunch of different things, but I'm lacking something. I feel like it's a bunch of separated details, compartmentalized details that have nothing to do with anything. It's just a bunch of different rituals that I do.
Formalities.
A bunch of formalities that I do. Thank you. And it doesn't really talk to me. And this is a very sad reality. What happens then? Some people start searching. Somebody called me this evening, just before I was coming to this to the lecture tonight. He's very concerned about a friend of his who was born to religious parents, lived a religious life all his life. He's now in his mid-40s, young man. And he decided that he doesn't want to leave Yiddishkeit, but he's practicing some type of very strange spiritual things that he's doing that have nothing to do with Yiddishkeit. Buddhism, Hinduism, Rahman al-Islam, God forbid, of what he's reading himself up. And what's his argument? His argument is he wants to have some spirituality. He doesn't just want to do a bunch of dry actions all his life. He wants to have something deeper. It's tragic that there are many people that don't know of the deep spiritual beauty and richness that Yiddishkeit has, which Hasidus reveals. So this is, on one foot, what Hasidus sets out to do, to reveal the beauty and the depth and the spirituality of all elements of Torah, of all elements of Yiddishkeit. Every major wisdom, every major system that was revealed, that was introduced to Yiddishkeit, came under attack. For example, Maimonides and many others. Maimonides in today's day and age is accepted by every single self-respecting Jew. Any Jew that is into Jewish teachings knows that Maimonides is one of the most authoritative books that you must read. And if you want to consider yourself at least somewhat of a scholar, or at least somewhat of a chacham in Jewish matters, you have to know Maimonides. You have to at least have somewhat of some type of knowledge of Maimonides. Right, so today Maimonides is accepted hands down as one of the major authorities in Jewish teachings. In his time, however, not a very long time ago, just 1,000 years, what's 1,000 years between friends? In his time, his books were burnt. And they weren't burnt by some type of evil anti-Semites, they were burnt by Jewish people. The encouragement of Jews. It was ridiculed. He was ridiculed. He was criticized. He was attacked. And so too with many, many other major, I shouldn't say many, many, quite a number of other figures that brought something revolutionary to Yiddishkeit, brought something fantastic to Jewish teachings, was criticized. It was attacked. And so too the Alter Rebbe, the founder of the Chabad movement of Hasidus, was also criticized, was also attacked, was also defamed, and no less, he was arrested due to trumped-up charges that he has these ambitions of taking over the government and so on and so forth. But really, this was not just an attack on the Alter Rebbe, on the founder of the Chabad movement, but this was an attack on the teachings of Hasidus. And had the Alter Rebbe been found guilty, it would have meant the end of the teachings of Chabad Hasidus for sure. And perhaps of all Hasidus. On Yutis Kislev, on the 19th day of Kislev, just 6 days before Hanukkah, before the date that we celebrate Hanukkah, we celebrate Rosh Hashanah for Hasidus when the Alter Rebbe was set free from prison. The celebration is not just the Alter Rebbe being set free from prison, but this was a victory for the teachings of Hasidus, meaning that spiritually, it was determined in heaven that the teachings of Hasidus should continue to be spread throughout the world, that the Jewish people, wherever they are, should continue enjoying this beautiful and profound teaching, that of Hasidus. These are the two major holidays. At the surface, they seem to have nothing to do with each other. At the surface, they also seem not to have anything to do with the fact that they're in the month of Kislev. It just happens to be that it happened to have happened in the third month of the year. The name Kislev we also didn't get to. We'll get to that in a moment. The letter Samach. What is Samach? Samach is a round circle. Makes a sound of S. The S sound. It's a round circle. The word Samach is connected with Somech, to support, to uphold. It is a round circle, which in a certain way points out perfection. And then we have the Keshet, Sagittarius. In Hebrew, the sign is referred to as Keshet. So I'll be using the word Keshet. What is a Keshet? The bow and arrow represents war. The bow also, Keshet, represents the rainbow. What kind of rainbow? What is a rainbow in Judaism? That God, after bringing the flood that destroyed the entire world, the entire earth, that flooded the earth, God made a vow that he will no longer do this. Never again will he destroy all mankind. And as a sign for his vow, Hashem showed a rainbow in the sky. So the rainbow we said we'll forgive you.
Thank you.
So the rainbow is a sign of God's kindness. It's something that is beyond. What is this exactly? So we have, on the one hand, we have the bow, which is a sign of fighting. On the other hand, it's a sign of forgiveness. How do these come together? What are these? How does it all come together? There are many other details, so let's get into the meat of things. When God created the world, the Torah tells us that God created the world in 7 days. The Torah goes on to in Genesis, there's a description, every single day of creation, what was created. And after every day of creation, God creates heaven and earth. And at the end of every day of creation, Hashem looks at the creation, and he sees that it is good. And Hashem says, and it is good. Which is a very interesting idea. How many of us at the end of the day of work, we criticize ourselves, we're unhappy with ourselves, somebody else finishes working, we're very critical. Hashem looks and he says, you know what, it's good. And Hashem said that it was good. After the second day of creation, this doesn't happen. So the first day of creation, Hashem says, and it's good. The second day, he's quiet. The fourth and fifth and sixth days, he all says it was good. On the third day, he says twice that it is good. So we have something of it here. We know that we read Chumash not just face value. We look, we find deeper messages in the wording. Just like every important document in our life. You read and reread and read again and read again, because we know that something that comes from Hashem is perfect and has a message not just in the general story, but also in the way in which it was written. So on the second day it's not good, or we don't know that it was good. On the third day it becomes good. Kabbalah speaks a lot about this. And it is written in Kabbalah that on the first day represents chesed. Chesed is kindness, benevolence, giving, goodness. The second day, the second one of the sefirot, are gevura, severity. Give me 1 second, please. On the second day, there's no saying that it's good. Why not? It's gvura, severity. On the third day, we have a double portion of good. Why? Because we have tiferes. Let me focus on these three for a moment. What is chesed? Chesed is the attitude of giving. A very benevolent person, very open person, very giving person, very open with the people around him. Not just very open in the secrets, but he speaks. He's a broad-minded person. Is this good? It's fantastic. It's beautiful. But it has its shortcomings as well. Because somebody that's always giving and giving and giving and giving and giving, these are people who just don't know how to shut up. You know, you sometimes meet people that speak and speak and speak and speak, You sometimes go to a lecture. Maybe I shouldn't speak about that. And the lecturer starts off on one topic and goes to another topic and goes to a third, fourth, fifth, sixth. After 30 minutes, the topic could be very interesting, but there are 73 million topics. You don't even know what he wants. Where is that coming from? So it's an abundance of chesed. The teacher just has so much to give, so much to share, that he can't stop himself. It's just, I just want to tell you more and more and more. Right. Now there's gvura. Gvura is severity. It's constrained. It's retracting. It's holding back. But on the other hand, there's something very redeeming to gvura. Because gvura enables us to focus whatever it is that we're doing. While chesed is constantly giving, gvura makes sure it's directed giving. It's focused giving. So the teacher that knows how to stay on topic is using a fine measure of gvura. Or the parent that knows how to say no to a child is using, once again, the quality of gvura. It's not a bad thing to say no to a child. It's necessary for a child's upbringing. It's necessary for us to hold back, not to reveal all information that we have within us in order for the people around us to succeed. But these are two different elements. And then comes Tiferes. Tiferes is a beautiful harmony of both these together. It's not just chesed with a drop of gvura mixed into it. It's not just gvura with a drop of chesed mixed into it. Both of those are very good and very important. But Tiferes is harmony. Is a harmonious mix of these two that makes something that is beautiful. What a Tiferes. The word Tiferes, which represents the number three, the word Tiferes means beauty. What is beauty? What is beauty? Perfection? How would you categorize that? Something that is one color can be very, very nice. Right? They'll say beauty is only eye of the beholder. Who can judge what is beauty? But I think that there are certain elements of beauty. What is the science of beauty? I don't know if there's a science of beauty. But I think that if we need to categorize beauty in a certain way, I think that this would be a fair description. Something that is single dimensional could be very nice, could be very pleasing. But I don't know if you'll ever describe it as beautiful.
So you mean proportion?
Proportion. Harmonious. When you have many details that are proportional with each other. But it takes many different elements together. Let's talk about a painting. We have some artists over here, right? You'll have a painting with, you'll take a beautiful color, blue, green, whatever color you prefer, and you'll put it down on a canvas. It could be nice, but will you ever look at it and say, wow, what a masterpiece? No. Why? It's just one, singular. There's no proportion, there's no depth, there are no details. On the other hand, you'll take many colors and you'll sprinkle them onto a canvas, or you'll splash them onto a canvas. Will that be beautiful? Unless you're doing modern art, maybe. But for the normal person, you just spray a bunch of colors onto a canvas, it won't necessarily be beautiful. When will it be beautiful? If it's proportional, if it's symmetrical, if it's if it's somehow systematic, if it's somehow in a proper proportion, if it's harmonious. That's when you have beauty. Not one color, not just 18 colors, but you have many colors that are there together, that are working in unison. That's when you have beauty. And so too it is also in our life. Harmony, having chesed and gvura together, and not just both elements of kindness and severity, but bringing them together in a harmonious way, proper proportion. This is the month of Kislev. The word Kislev in Hebrew, and I should say that the Hebrew months, really the words came up with the Jewish after the first exile. when Jewish people came back from Babylon, that's when they brought the Hebrew months, Hebrew names of the months. So the word Kislev is connected with the word for security or trust. What are all these things? So we have security and trust. We have these miracles, these supernatural events of Hanukkah and Yitzchak Kislev. We have the idea of trust in the letter Samach, leaning on something, relying on something. The bow that speaks of a covenant. How do all these details fall in together? What is it? So there's a famous saying, there's a famous prayer that most every Jewish person knows, if not for any other reason, because of the popular song, Oseh Shalom Bimroma, right? Hu Yaseh Shalom Aleinu. He who makes peace above should make peace, should bring peace on us. Right? Which speaks, which is a beautiful prayer that we ask God for peace. But what is the meaning of this prayer? Oseh Shalom Aleinu, he who makes peace above, Hu Yaseh Shalom Aleinu, he should bring peace upon us. What does this actually mean? What does one have to do with the other? And who's the one that makes peace above? Who's arguing above? Above who are they arguing anyway? If they're above, if above refers to heaven, why are they arguing? And how does he make peace? How do you make peace? How do two people live together? So the meaning of this verse is, Oseh Shalom Bimromav, there are different types of angels. There's Sar Shalmayim, Sar Shalesh. There's the energy of fire and energy of water. This is not just referring to particular angels, but this is referring to different approaches that God has created within the person himself. There are different types of person. There are people of fire and there are people of water. There are people that are passionate, there are people that are solid. There are people that are solid, that are quiet. There are people that are calm, cold, emotional, rational. There are different types of people. Sometimes we'll say that even within ourselves, there are different times of our day. Sometimes we might be like fire. Sometimes we might be like water. Sometimes people mix the fire and water together. That creates a whole different breed. But what is this? So how does God bring peace between the angel, the energy of fire, and the energy of water? And this is a very important question, because how could we apply this to our life? How could we bring peace into our life? Within our own life, how could we bring peace? And how could we unite? How could we bring together two different people, one of whom is fire and the other one is water? Are they destined to snap at each other and not to get along? And if they are married to each other, they're destined to live in misery? How could one bring peace between fire and water? And the answer is, there are two ways. And we try to do this sometimes when we encounter somebody who is different than us. So we try to overpower them. We try to overwhelm them. We try to speak and speak and speak and speak until they just had enough of us. We have our different methods in which we try to overpower the people that we come in contact with that are different than us. You know, many of us naturally love the people that agree with them. Oh, you are so smart. Why are you so smart? Because you agree with everything I say. You laugh at all my jokes. You agree with everything that I say. Right? I love you. Why? Because you're like me. You don't oppose me. You're not against me. I could connect to you. What happens with another person that thinks differently than you? Quite naturally, we get uncomfortable. It's somehow a challenge to our ego. It's somehow a challenge to our existence. What then? So how does it work in heaven? Who puts out whom? Does the fire cause the water to evaporate? Or does the water put out the fire? Between these two energies, who wins? And this is the depth of the verse, Oseh Shalom Bimromav. He who makes peace above. He who makes peace between the energy of fire and the energy of water. They both continue to exist, but they realize, and the reason that they exist, and the reason that they can exist as individuals, and maintaining their identity, is because there's something that is greater than them. There's something that is greater than the fire, and there's something that is greater than the water. And both the fire and the water, both the energy of the fire and the energy of the water, are focused on that which is greater than them. And in so doing, they maintain their identity. So I'm not preoccupied with trying to cause you to stop existing. I'm living for something higher. I'm living for something greater. Excuse me. This is very true in a relationship as well. You'll have people that are very different from each other. How could they get along? As long as they're focused on their own identity, as long as they're focused on their own characteristics, on their own personality, and so on and so forth, it is not possible for them to get along. You know, in the beginning of the relationship, when everybody's all excited and emotional and so on and so forth, it might be easier, but at a certain point, when you start living life, well, second, what's with my identity? What's with my personality? You knew who this is, who I am, and you knew this is who I am, so who should give in to who? So as long as I'm focused on my personality, as long as I'm focused on myself, there's no way that the two of us will get along. Unless we both surrender to something that is higher. This is a very, very important and a fundamental quality referred to in Kabbalah and Chassidus as bittul, humility. And with humility, one is able to, people that are humble are able to communicate with everybody that is around them. No one gets in their way. You're not a threat to me. I could be water, and you could be burning fire, but you're not a threat to me. There was a story with the third Chabad Rebbe, the Tzamach Tzedek. Somebody once came to the Tzamach Tzedek, Rabbi Menachem Mendel, and he said to him that, you know, people step all over me. I feel bad when I go to shul, people step all over me. People step all over my ego. And then Tzamach Tzedek answered him, who asked you to become a doormat? That when anybody walks in, he's stepping on you. And it sounds like a cute exchange, doesn't sound too deep, but I find it to be very profound. When I'm preoccupied with myself, and all I am is thinking about myself, anything that a person does that I don't appreciate, he's immediately stepping on me. This is an expression of ego. And sometimes ego expresses itself in humility. What appears to be humility. No, I can't do it. You speak to somebody about doing a mitzvah. No, I can't do it. It's not me. The previous Rebbe once asked a young man to go speak in a shul, to go teach, to give a lecture there. And he started, trying to back out. And he's like, I'm not sure if I made a cut out for it. I'm not sure if I'm the right person, and so on and so forth. And the previous Rebbe told him something that was very sharp. The previous Rebbe said, the shiflus shel sheker, just wrote down the exact wording, at least the way I heard it, I'm sorry. Anava shalebim kaima, yisudosa bagaiva. Humility in the wrong place comes from ego. What does true humility mean? True humility does not mean that I'm a shmata, that I let people trample all over me, and I let people to disrespect me, and so on and so forth. That's called a shmata. That's a person that has no self-value, no self-worth. That's not what humility means. Humility means, bittul means, my life is so focused on something that is higher, that is greater than I, that I'm not preoccupied with you gave me honor, you didn't give me honor, you do agree with me, you don't agree. Sure, I have my opinion. But I'm focused. I'm living for something that is much bigger than myself. I have something that is much taller than I. What do you have? You have a number three. One is unity, is oneness. There's nothing else that exists. And that is expressed by the month of Tishrei with the abundance of holidays and so on and so forth. That is expressed by Chesed. Two creates a problem. There is suddenly a duality. So who should give in to who? How should we work this out? Should you get half? Should I get half? What should we do about this? There's suddenly a possibility for friction. And therefore, on day two, Hashem doesn't say anything because there's a possibility for friction. And this is the month of Cheshvan. On the month of Cheshvan, the month of past year, there are no holidays. We spoke about the idea that you have to generate the holidays, that you have to create, you have to create the beauty of air. In the month of Kislev, we have three. What's the idea of three? A table can stand on three legs. Three gives us the ability that the two are able to surrender to something that is higher than them, to three. And speaking in our case, when we talk about Bittul, the idea of Bittul is that two parties surrender to something that is by far greater than them. So when I speak to couples, one of the things that I try to emphasize upon them, and particularly couples that obviously if they're coming to speak to me, many times I have a connection with a rabbi. So one of the things that's very important, that before you get married, or just after you get married, or when, find a particular rabbi or spiritual mentor that both husband and wife respect. So that if there's ever a dispute, if there's ever an argument, before it spirals into a vicious fight, let's go to somebody else. Let's go to a third party. Let the third party decide, yay or nay, right or left. What's the point of doing this? This idea of that there's a third party that is that enables us to bring a true unity. In our personal life, there's my fire and there's my water. Which one? How do I bring it all together? If I'm not living for myself, if I'm not living for my own ego, if I'm not living to make myself feel better. I'm living for something that is higher. I'm living with a higher purpose. In so doing, as ironic as it sounds, that when I become humble, when I start living for something that is greater than I, that's when I'm able to fulfill myself, because then there's no challenge. That's when I'm able to express myself. That's when I'm able to be happy. But you just surrendered. But that's when you're truly living. And this is the month of Kislev. So the idea of trust, security, safety. What kind of trust are we talking about? Or the letter Samach. It's not just a bunch of random elements that are brought together somehow because of the cosmology or because of the Kabbalah that seems not to have any connection. But every single detail feeds in to this concept that the month of Kislev is a month of Bittul. Is the month in which we are able to tap in to this third element. That we're able to tap in to this higher element. So, for example, you'll see on your chart that the sense of the month of Kislev is sleeping. What's the idea of sleeping? Many times, sleeping is viewed as a negative thing. Fluffed. But in this context, it's not. There are many people today, unfortunately, nevach. Can't sleep. Why not? Not because they're constantly thinking about what else could I do to bring the geula. What else could I do to help another person? But they try to go to sleep at night and say, Gatenisht. I'm stressed. I'm anxious. I'm nervous. Well, some people are going to take pills, and other people do other funny things. It's a reality. Where does it all come from? Lack of trust. What happens what do you gain when you're anxious? I remember a friend of mine, when we were young yeshiva bakrim, young teenagers. It's a friend of mine. Look, what do you gain by being stressed out? What do you gain by being afraid? You don't get anything. Nothing changes. And the reality, nothing changes in reality. But it's a certain, something goes on inside your system in which you question and in which you challenge. You're nervous. What's going to be? Oy vey. But a person that is able to sleep, what does that mean? Without artificially, without artificial help. He has trust in Hashem. It says about one of the great kings of the Jewish people. At one point, there was an army that was about to attack the Jewish people. Chizkiah, and he turns to Hashem, he says, you know what? I'm going to sleep. You'll take care of the battle. And sure enough, miraculously, the Jewish people, the enemy ran away, and so on and so forth. The Jewish people had a victory. Where did I come from? It wasn't, God forbid, running away from responsibility. But he has such faith in Hashem, such trust in Hashem. He wasn't worried. He wasn't worried. What do I have to worry about? I only worry if it's on my shoulders. When I realize, however, my life is not about me. My life is about doing that which Hashem wants from me. I'm completely surrendering to Hashem. Not just to use this as a trick, you know, to run away, God forbid, from responsibilities. But true trust in Hashem, that's the month of Kislev. As we have the 19th day of Kislev, when the Alter Rebbe, when we celebrate Rosh Hashanah for Chassidus, the Alter Rebbe said of one of the Psukim of Tehillim, so Hashlech al Hashem Yehavcha. Throw your worries, throw your anxieties onto Hashem. Throw your pekel on Hashem. It's a famous anecdote that this guy, Moshe, was walking down a path in the old shtetl. And sure enough, a Yankel passes by, a horse and buggy. Says, Yankel turns to Moshe, says, Moshe, where are you headed to? He says, I'm going to the city. It'll take him another 17 hours to walk. So Yankel says, oh, why don't you hop onto my wagon? I'm going there as well. I'll drop you off. Pleasure. So Moshe says, wow, thank you so much. Moshe's carrying a heavy load on his back. And Yankel stops, and Moshe climbs onto the wagon, and he schleps his bag, and he keeps his bag on his shoulder. In the middle, after a few minutes of riding, Yankel turns around, and he sees Moshe sitting there with the heavy sack on his shoulders. He says, Moshe, I understand you. Why don't you put your bag down? So Moshe says, you're doing me such a favor in giving me a ride. Why do you also have to schlep my bag? A lot of times we do this, and so it's funny because we put it in this context, it's a cute story. But the truth of the matter is we also do this with Hashem. Hashem is carrying us. Hashem is bringing us, taking us, and so on and so forth. But our stresses and our anxieties, we carry on our back. Hashem says, why don't you put it down? Put it on me. I'm taking care of it. So we say, oh, you know, you're doing enough for me. Yeah, let me carry the rest. It's a joke. He's carrying the wagon. This is the month of Kislev. And this brings us to the bow. And this brings us to the wars of Hanukkah. How were the Hashmonaim able to fight against such a mighty army? How was a small family able to fight against the Greeks? Makes no sense. But when you put this in context, when you realize that the month of Kislev is the month of Bittul, is the month of Tiferes, of harmony. It's the month of surrendering to something that's higher. It's a month of trust. All of this brings out the quality of this month, the sensitivity, and the ability to surrender to something that's much higher, to have a much happier life. The ability to live for something that is much higher, to live for something that's much greater than us and all the challenges and the stresses that we might experience in our life, to trust and to rely on Hashem. This is an energy that exists in this month. It's the third leg for the table that enables the table to stand. The bow as well, excuse me, or the arrow, the keshet, that is used, that is the sign of the month, was used by the Chashmonaim, is also connected to the rainbow. This is all connected. How do you go to battle? When you realize that you are empowered, when you realize that there's a power that is enabling you to do that which you want and that which is important for you to do. This empowers you to take on your enemy, so to speak, to take on your foe, to take on any challenges that you might be facing. So to summarize, the month of Kislev is the month of Bittul. This Bittul, this surrendering, is the month of Tiferes, the month of harmony. This harmony enables us to overcome any of our challenges and enables us to face any challenge and any battle. Why? Not because we're so great, but we tap into an energy that is by far greater than us. We're able to suspend our life and to live in a way that empowers us because of our trust in Hashem and our trust in something that is much greater than us. May we all be successful in tapping into this energy and to this holiness and celebrate the Yom Tovim of this month. There are many other minor Yom Tovim, definitely on the Hasidic calendar, but they all express the same idea. The Bittul, the harmony, and to living for something that is by far greater, that empowers us to enable to overcome our challenges and to have a stress-free life, to having an anxiety-free life because of our trust in Hashem, not, God forbid, because of running away, because of embracing something that is by far greater than us. May we all be successful in that and have a very happy and very healthy and successful month. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.